Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the experience. Yes, we are back, and this week's guest is actually someone that my friend Ig set me up with. He's one of the people that I met who live right up the road. Neighbors, essentially. Who is a friend of William Henry's, if you can believe that. I think I mentioned it on a previous episode that my wife and I went to check out an Airbnb when we were doing our wedding vows ceremony for one of her friends to stay at. And the woman who runs the place and her bestie Ig were there, and they both are friends with William and Claire Henry. So, of course, William Henry is my predecessor on unknowncountry.com. So, an interesting bit of too synchronistic to be coincidence, for my taste, anyway. And so, now we are friends, and he is hooking me up with his friends who have had high strangest experiences. And Kathy Cogliano is this week's guest. She is hopefully the first of many. keep them coming, Ig. Keep them coming. And this is one of those, we got a little bit of everything here episodes, which I love. And it went extra long. It went the full 2 hours. So I will actually step out of the way now and just get into it with Kathy Cogliano. Let's listen to her life of high strangeness experiences. And for subscribers, you think the thing is going to end, and then it doesn't. And then she's like, I think I asked her, you know, is there anything that we didn't get to that you wanted to? And she's like, well, there was this one time when I was in Egypt. And then it's like, well, we've got to hear that. So we will. Non-subscribers, you will get a little bit over the first half hour or so. So please do consider clicking that subscribe tab and get the entire episode commercial free. Either way, we're going to get into it with Kathy Cogliano after these messages for non-subscribers. For subscribers, let's go. Aloha, Jeremy Vaney here, and I want to tell you about my latest undertaking, OurUndoing.com. OurUndoing.com is a multimedia website where if you watch, if you read, if you listen, without trying to absorb knowledge like we do with normal learning, and without the normal judgmental filters that we use to compare and contrast so-called spiritual knowledge, if we watch, if we read, if we listen without all of that, we may just wake up to our full human nature. That is what this website is for. It's not about what we're doing, it's about who we are, truly are, when we're off the pendulum of duality. If your life is about seeking truth above all else, look no further. Join me at OurUndoing.com.
Whitley Strieber has published an incredible 2-volume historical novel called In Hitler's House, under his open pseudonym Jonathan Lane. This amazing story follows the life of William Weber, who meets Hitler while touring Germany in 1931 and becomes his friend and confidant, but then, when he realizes the truth, becomes a spy in Hitler's house for the Allies. Living a life of terrible danger, he falls in love with another of Hitler's secret friends, also a spy in his house. This is a story of espionage and desperate love, and the deepest portrait of Adolf Hitler ever created. Don't miss In Hitler's House, available in paperback and as an ebook on Amazon.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome to the program Kathy Cogliano. Kathy, thank you for doing this. Much appreciated.
Jeremy, my pleasure, and thank you for having me on your show, The Experience.
And thank you also for sending me a little checklist of your experiences that we can just sort of go down. But before we do that, I want to ask you privately, right before the show here, I asked if you wanted to use a pseudonym, and you said no, that you're getting out there more with this stuff. You're starting to write about it and be more public about it. Why did that change for you? Why did you decide that you wanted to go public with your experiences?
Well, gosh, my experience, you know, they go way back to, you know, being a child, going forward. And I just, you know, I've had these abilities come to me. I've done some training in, you know, different healing modalities as well as spiritual training. And I just literally, through another medium, had a message from my dad who passed away in 2015. And he literally was yelling and saying to me, get out of the closet. And everybody that was around me that heard this message gasped. And I said, oh, no. He's talking about the spiritual closet that I've put myself in. And for whatever reason, and I'm not quite sure, I have put myself in the spiritual closet. And the message from my dad was, get out of the closet. And that's pretty much where I'm at right now. I'm stepping out. I refer to it as stepping through a threshold, and I'm owning my gifts. And it's been a beautiful unfolding, and it's all happening pretty quickly. So I'm owning it now.
What do you think is important about that? I mean, is it important to you? Do you feel like it's important to an interested public?
Yes, I do. I think it's important to share, you know, my story. I'm sure there are others out there who, you know, probably since, you know, childhood have had these unusual experiences. And, you know, might be sitting with it, keeping it all in, you know, in their spiritual closet, so to say. And, you know, because, you know, it's one of those things, you're never quite sure how, you know, other people are going to, you know, be open to, you know, your personal journey and or believe it. I guess I'm at a point now where that doesn't matter to me anymore. So I'm out of the closet. I'm walking my path, open and honestly. And
you're footloose and fancy free.
It's all good, Jeremy. It's wonderful. It's been a wonderful, wonderful, huge journey. So I'm very blessed.
Excellent. Okay. So let's start off with, your earliest experiences. It seems like fairly early on, you had a clairvoyant experience and a visitation from your grandfather. Tell us what that was.
I did, Jeremy. Gosh, I was probably about 7, and we had visited my grandfather, who was in the hospital. Back in the day, they wouldn't let children go in, and so we stood on a hill, I'll never forget this, outside his hospital window, and we waved to him, and he waved back, and, you know, we went home, and that night, I'm in bed and sound asleep, and out of nowhere, I'm wide awake. I sit up and I'm like, what's going on? I look to the corner of the room, and in the TV, I shared the bedroom with my sister. In the little TV we had on a TV stand in the corner of the room was my grandfather fully in the entire screen talking to me. His mouth is moving. He's very animated. And I just dove under the covers. I did not know what was going on. I was so scared. And I can remember looking over at my sister. She's sound asleep. And only to then get up the next morning and have my dad call us all downstairs to tell us kids that my grandfather had passed away that evening. So, you know, that was a visitation from him. That truly was the beginning of this journey. You know,
and did you hear a voice, or did you just see the mouth moving?
No, I just saw the mouth moving, which is interesting. You know, maybe had I not been so afraid, I might have been able to hear, because I have heard spirit communicate before. So, but then, no, it was just I could see his lips moving, that he was trying to talk to me. So it was really, really neat. And then what happened when I went to his service, of course, as a kid, that was the first time I had been, or any of us kids had been, to a wake. And so there's my grandfather laid out in the casket. And my sister tells this story, because I don't remember it, that evidently I, upon entering the funeral home and saw his body, I freaked out and started screaming and crying that Grampy's not dead. He's alive. I've seen him. He's alive. So to the point that my dad had to take me back to my grandparents' house, because I clearly was a little upset by the whole thing. But
when you saw him in the TV, was the TV on or off?
No, it was off. Nope.
And did you see him like superimposed over the TV, or was it as if you were watching a TV show with light?
Yeah, he was in the TV.
And do you remember there being a background?
No, I don't remember a background. But I did fully see his whole form. It was as though I was watching a TV show. It was really quite something. And that has just always stuck with me. Every time I speak of it, I can clearly see him in that TV. And he has since come. He comes to me. I have visitations from him. We were very close, he and I, growing up. And whenever he does come, he presents with the smell of sweet pipe tobacco. Not pipe tobacco, tobacco, because he used to roll his own cigarettes. Hmm. And like a cherry tobacco. And that was always a smell that I associated with him. So when he does come for a visit, I smell the tobacco. So it's pretty cool.
Do you remember in the TV, do you remember if his face was emoting anything? If it was, you know, maybe urgent for him to talk to you, or was he happy, sad? I mean, do you remember any sort of emotion or urgency?
Like urgency. Like he was really trying to tell me something, because he kept talking. I remember that his mouth never stopped moving. And I think that's kind of what creeped me out the most. He was clearly trying to communicate to me.
And when you talked to him later in life, did you ever ask him about that?
No, I never did. Good question though, huh?
Next time.
Yes, definitely.
Were you freaked out the next time you saw him?
No, that was many years later. I've trained with different mediums over the years and, you know, really kind of delved into, my mediumship abilities. So it was at that point, you know, years ago that he first came to me.
Okay. And so the next thing on the list is that you had an out-of-body experience. What year, or if you remember roughly, like what age were you?
Actually, two of them. The first one, I was very young. I was probably 5. It was very interesting because I'm on a swing. You know how you, as a kid, when you're little on a swing, you kind of lay across it on your tummy. And I'm just kind of, you know, swinging back and forth that way by myself on the swing set that was in our yard. And all of a sudden, I'm up above looking down at myself. And I had the distinct thought, looking at myself, I thought, I have a really good, healthy body in this lifetime. Now I'm 5 years old, and that was the thought I had. And I could see myself swinging in the swing, and I no sooner had the thought than I'm evidently back in the body. I'm swinging, and it was just kind of like, oh, yeah, I'm looking down at my legs. I'm going, yeah, this is a good body. So, yeah, that was interesting. The second time happened, I was probably – I would say like 9. Again, we were living in Brockton at the time. And I got permission from my parents to walk up to our little corner general store with this older girl in the neighborhood. And normally I wouldn't be allowed to walk that far. So we're walking up and we're on a sidewalk and we're walking in front of our elementary school. And I go to step off the sidewalk to cross the driveway entrance of the school. And we crossed that, and I'm about to step up on the sidewalk on the other side when I had the other outer body experience where, again, I am like up above. I'm looking down. I am seeing myself walking. I'm seeing myself talking. I see, you know, I'm very engaged talking to my friend. And I was up there for a bit of time, and because I can remember thinking, what is going on? Well, I'm like up here looking down, but yet I'm down there walking and talking. So it was very interesting. I no sooner kind of get up to the next part of the walkway where I had like this rush. Like it's hard to explain. It was like this rush feeling that I must have gone back into my body, because I remember I stumbled a bit to the point that the other girl had said to me, are you okay? And I'm like, yeah, but felt kind of wobbly. It was a very odd feeling. But then, you know, as a kid, you just brush it off, and we kept walking, you know, to the store. But I have a very vivid recollection of that.
We'll be back after this.
The new unknowncountry.com is on the way. There'll be exciting new graphics, much easier navigation, the ability to subscribe either with your credit card or using PayPal, the return of our free message board and subscriber chat room, and so much more. The new site will be intuitive and easy to use, but it will also be demonstrated and explained on Whitley's YouTube channel. As to when, well, we're hopefully just weeks away.
You know, The Afterlife Revolution is a funny book. It makes people happy, even though it's about the afterlife and thinking about crossing over. It made me happy to write it. And the reason it did was that I was actually in touch with Anne while I was writing it. And not only that, she proved it. She proved it clearly and completely. When you read the book, you'll see what I mean. You'll see why Dr. Gary Schwartz, who is one of the leading experts on the afterlife, considers it such an important book, why he wrote a foreword for it. Because this is about something real and incredible that we are told every day not to believe that we have souls and that we have an afterlife. Well, we do. We do. And the Afterlife Revolution is going to open the door for you, so you're not going to be thinking to yourself, maybe I don't, when you do. And that's why it's a book of joy. Go on Amazon, take a look at the great reviews, and get yourself a copy. It's available for your Kindle, it's available in paperback, and there's an audiobook read by me. And let me tell you something, you can hear something in my voice. People tell me that, and I think it's true. You know what it is? It's the inner joy that is part of me and has become part of me since this extraordinary thing happened. I have to say, Anne Strieber was a remarkable person in this life, and she still is. Get it today.
Whitley Strieber's nonfiction is magical, powerful, and thought-provoking. From Communion to The Afterlife Revolution, there is no body of work like it in the world. Nothing even approaches it. And not only that, his wonderful fiction, from The Wolfen to his latest novel, New, offers reading and listening entertainment that you will never forget. And where do you find all this in one place? At Strieber.com. That's where. Every Whitley Strieber book available for sale is there. So don't wait. Go to Strieber.com and start exploring. There's only one Whitley and only one place to find all his work. Strieber.com.
Welcome back.
So when you were talking and all of that, were you bi-local, or were you, your sense of yourself was completely out of your body watching this unfold?
Oh, completely out. Yeah. Completely out.
Where did you live, incidentally, in Brockton? Was it the west side, or?
Yes, on the west side.
Okay, good. The safe side.
You got it, the good side. Yes.
I lived in the crap side, and I remember West Brockton being the good side where everybody wanted to live. So good for you.
It was a nice-sided town. It was. And that was the Hancock School, elementary school, that I was walking in front of at the time. But no, that was a full out-of-body experience.
Interesting. And so did this freak you out in the sense of, oh, I'm out of my body, how am I going to get back in there? Or, you know, how long did this take? Did you just sort of snap back into your body?
I don't think it took that long, because I didn't have that thought process fully. It seemed pretty quickly I'm back down into the body. Very odd.
And that second time that you're out of body, do you have the same sort of mature, out-of-body attitude that you did when you were five?
I don't remember, to be honest. I just remember really feeling the sense of separateness, that I'm up here, but yet what's going on? Because I see myself down there.
And when you said you were five, right, the first time? Did I get there?
Yes.
Okay. Uh-huh. And so when you were five and you had this out-of-body experience and you had that mature thought about yourself, did it feel like you when you came back into your body and started thinking? I mean, is it all a smooth transition, or does it feel like one is an altered state of consciousness from the other?
The five-year-old experience did feel like it was altered, you know, because it truly felt like that wasn't my child thought. That was somebody else's thought. So it's hard to explain. So it's almost like I was looking at this five-year-old child, but yet I was having this other thought that, this is a good, healthy body. So I think it was more of a separate experience, if that makes sense.
Yeah. Okay. So now the out-of-body experiences, I mean, are, when you think about them later, after they happen, are they at all frightening, or is it all just sort of taken in stride?
It depends on the situation, because I have had a few other out-of-body experiences. The out-of-body experience I had, jumping way forward, when I was in Italy, in Turin, Italy, and I was in front of the Shroud of Turin, I had a crazy out-of-body experience there, to the point that I had a couple of readings from some people before I went on this trip who kind of saw me having these unusual experiences, to the point that one woman said to me, make sure you ask one of your, you know, fellow travelers to hang on to you when you're standing in front of the Shroud. And I looked at her and I thought, wow, why? What's going to happen? And she just said, you know, I have a sense you're going to probably have an out-of-body experience. Just make sure she hangs on to you so that there's almost like a tether that in case you do, you know, have that experience, you'll come back.
Okay. And in these out-of-body experiences, are all of your senses going? Can you hear? Can you smell?
Mm-hmm.
You can smell. And can you, are you seeing as if through two eyes?
Yeah.
And do you see your own body? Like, could you put your hand up to your face, do you think, if you're out of body?
Not with the Shroud experience, no. That was, let's just say I left the earth plane. I went up to a really high realm, that particular experience. So that was very different from, you know, the experiences I had as a child.
So what was going on in your life, just your everyday life when you were a kid? At those, if you remember, like, was it a time of great change or tumultuousness, or was it just normal everyday stuff, life?
You know, I have to say, basically normal stuff. You know, I had those experiences when we were living in Brockton. It was shortly after that second experience when I was about seven. I want to say probably when I was 8 or 9, we moved to Connecticut, and we were living on the sub base in New London, Connecticut. And my dad, you know, was a career Marine at the time. And it was there on the sub base that I had my UFO encounter. So that was a little unusual, but I have to say, you know, overall looking back at childhood, you know, it was pretty normal for the most part. And, you know, I have a sister, I'm the oldest of three. So I have a sister, Karen, and a brother, Kevin. And, I'd say it was fairly normal.
Is it normal for you to, travel the world and go to these various places? I mean, maybe it is now, but like back then, was that something that your family did, or is that something that you decided to do on your own when you started traveling?
No, that wasn't a part of growing up for me. We basically, you know, outside of Connecticut, we pretty much settled in Massachusetts for the rest of my childhood. And so that my travel later in life here was probably started about, I started traveling to these sacred sites, being guided to do so probably about, I want to say, 2013 onwards. And pretty much every year I'm kind of guided to take, you know, take these travels. And, you know, again, it was one of those things, Jeremy, that, you know, I was training at the time taking Reiki. And it, just going through that process of working in, you know, those realms, it seemed to kind of open something for me. And that teacher, Nancy, you know, also was, you know, a medium. She would, you know, give me readings, and she would tap into, you know, all kinds of stuff, past lives. But she had always said to me, one of the first things that happened when she read me, she said, Kathy, spirit is showing me you standing on the edge of a cliff and your toes are curled over and you're looking down into this abyss. But spirit is asking you, are you ready to take the leap of faith? Are you ready to jump in to this whole spiritual journey or not? And it would be okay if I said no. And at the time when she asked me that in this reading, I fully understood what spirit was trying to show her, because that's what it felt like, that I was on the edge And I don't know if I'm ready to jump in yet, but the minute she asked me, am I ready? Spirit wants to know if you're ready to jump. I said, yep, I'm jumping. And it has been a fast track ever since then. So it was kind of funny how that all started.
Okay. Well, we'll definitely come to the spiritual jumping, but you've already tantalized me with this UFO on a military base. Let that go.
Oh, good Lord. I was walking to school, and it's, it was funny because I don't honestly remember. I was walking alone. So, I think obviously my sister, brother, they kind of went off to school on their own. And so here I am walking by myself. But yet all of a sudden, I'm kind of, as a kid, not paying too much attention to anything, but I look up and ahead of me, probably not even a half a mile, a quarter of a mile. I look up and there's this huge, I know it's cliche to say, but it did somewhat look like a cigar-shaped ship. And I knew intuitively enough as I looked at it, I saw no wings. It appeared to, there was no sound to it, which was interesting because a craft that big, I thought, why aren't I hearing it? And it kind of was like vibrating. It was silver, but it had like darker ends that seemed to be kind of spinning. But yet I wasn't really seeing flashes of light per se. It was almost like more of the sun, shining off of the really shiny metallic piece of the ship, which was in the middle. So it was very odd. And it just hovered. It hovered there. And I just stopped and I just kept looking at this and it stayed there for a bit. And then I just thought, okay, this is really weird. And I started to run to school. And at that point, when I started to run to school, I looked up and it wasn't there. It had gone. And mind you, no sound at all during this whole thing. It was, and it definitely wasn't a plane.
Did any of your family have any experiences?
Not that I know of. No.
Did you talk to them about yours as they were unfolding? Like, would you be like, Mommy, I saw a UFO?
No, you know what? I never did. I never mentioned that at all. And that I find kind of curious, honestly, why I just had this intuitive sense not to talk about it. Hmm. And I never did.
It's interesting because, in the UFO lore, in the nefarious murk of UFO lore, the shady version of that is that there is some sort of quote unquote alien intelligence that is influencing you not to tell, so that it can keep doing, whatever it's doing unimpeded. But really, the more that we delve into this material, the more you see that these experiences are in some way for you. And so if they're for you, it will do no one else any good to know about them. They can't help you.
True,
they can't
exactly give
you anything except faulty guidance by telling you what an unknown means, according to their own belief system. So what good would it do to tell anyone in the first place, I guess?
Yeah, no, that makes sense. It truly does. It because I look back on this and now that I'm really putting pen to paper and I'm, chronicling my experiences, I did kind of shake my head over that, remembering that, I never did say anything to anybody about that. So there might be some truth to be had in that possible. Maybe I wasn't meant to speak of it.
So the next grouping of stuff happens as an adult. So between childhood and adult, there's nothing. You have a pretty good teen life, normal.
Yeah, I'd say that.
And so do you forget about this stuff? I mean, does it just sort of go away and then it reappears in your life and you're like, oh, yeah, this?
No, those experiences as a kid, I always kind of held on to. I wasn't out there talking about it, but I always could recall them with exact clarity whenever I would think of them. And I don't know. I do look back now sometimes and I do think that perhaps those experiences were setting me up for what was to come. Possibly.
Did you obsess over them? I mean, would you tell them to friends and things like this?
No,
would you draw out your experiences? Huh?
Nope.
Okay.
Never told anybody any of it. No, not until recently, as I was really starting to write and starting to have more experiences beyond my childhood ones, and, you know, and then meeting like-minded people who, you know, I could share some of this with, and they wouldn't look at me like I was crazy.
Well, yeah. Although I think less and less people are, you know, I think the looking at you like you're crazy thing is mostly a defense mechanism, because we've been told that we need to look at each other like we're crazy when we tell these stories. Because, you know, I've had my own experiences. I used to write for UFO Magazine, and I remember when my grandfather died. I've told this story ad nauseum, but when my grandfather died, going to the funeral in Vermont, and how many people, I mean, relatives, neighbors, various people who knew that I was this writer and had these experiences, would come up to me and start whispering about their own experiences, you know, from this small conservative town. And then I thought about, like, I mean, they're from Groton, Vermont, which is population practically nobody. So, like, is a whole town being abducted? Is a whole town having these experiences? And then the more you look, the more you realize, wait a minute, this is the thing that's happening to most, if not all of us, and we're just taught not to talk about it to each other. You know, it's like the New York subway system. We're all crammed in there, but we're all staring at our shoes and our phones and trying not to talk to each other.
I think so. I agree. Yeah, I think it's somewhat a you know, we're conditioned not to talk about it.
Having said that, let's get to your crazy levitation experience.
Let's jump into crazy. Love it.
This is the first of your adult experiences?
Yeah. Okay. There were many. And it's interesting because most of these experiences I'll speak of happened in my previous home here in Plymouth. I now live in a smaller home, you know, within the same neighborhood, so to say, but, you know, a downsize. But a lot of things happen at this other home. And so it's kind of interesting. I'm not sure why, but probably because that's was at a point in my journey where I was really starting to open up, and I was, you know, so I think, you know, having taken that big leap of faith, I think, you know, spirit was just like, bring it on. Let's have it start to roll. And so the one experience, and I tell you, I still am rocked by this one. And I always, am looking for someone to help me explain what could have happened, but I was up in my office. I was on the phone to a friend, and I was sitting at my desk, and he says, oh my gosh, he goes, you know, I got to hang up. We've had a family emergency. I'll have to call you back. So I hung up the phone, and I literally, without thinking at all, picked up a pen, and I wrote down three words: male cousin suicide. And I dropped the pen, and I thought, what the heck is that all about? And I thought, oh, I no sooner put down that pen than a beam of light, and I'm talking a beam of light that I could see it. It was probably an inch wide, and it comes from through the roof of my house. My office was on the second floor, through the room, over my right shoulder. It strikes a paperclip, a big butterfly paperclip I had, which actually looks like four intersecting pyramids. So the beam of light hit that paperclip on one end. It sparked. It made an absolute, like almost like a bang noise. It sparked the paperclip. So the paperclip now is, that spark is going around the entire shape of the paperclip. And when it comes to the other end of the paperclip, there's another loud, like, bang, pop, and all of the like, sparks and things die out. And I just sat there and I thought, what just happened? I was in awe. I had no fear, which I thought was interesting. But I thought, oh, my God, what just happened? And so as I sat there, the phone rang, and my friend called back, and I said, gosh, is everything okay? And he said, my cousin John had just shot himself at his mother's house. Male cousin suicide. So that, to this day, I don't know what happened, but that was an absolute beam of light and fully able to be seen. And to see it. And what I don't understand is that was a metal paperclip. but yet it ignited the paperclip. So it sparked the entire shape of that paperclip, which was probably all said and done, probably like 2 inches by 2 inches. It was a large paperclip. But that to me was just, that was like the beginning of some other very interesting things at that house. But that I haven't really had anybody definitively tell me anything about that felt like it would be right.
So when it sparked the paperclip, did it make a shape of the butterfly?
It was like a sparkler. So it followed the entire shape of the paperclip. So it was like it was sparking on the actual shape of the paperclip. And this is metal. But yet this thing followed the entire shape of the paperclip. It was quite something.
Yeah, that's interesting. Well, it just reminds me of, Whitley Strieber's work with his deceased wife in writing about the significance of the white moth and how it has to do with death, essentially. I don't know. There might be something in there, but I don't think...
Interesting.
I mean, I think these are, probably things for you to work on, I tend to start to look at this stuff not as like what is an explanation for the literal thing that happened or even the meaning behind it anymore, but like, why is this happening in the first place?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, okay, yeah. So why would that, why bother with that? It's a long way to go. And so.
I think what I, part of me feels that it was definitely connected to, I believe could be connected to the experience of, I tapped into what was happening with my friend. So to, before the beam of light, to write down the three words, I made a connection to that situation. Like I saw it, so I wrote down three words, without knowing at the time what I was doing, I guess. And so perhaps, the beam of light was almost like an exclamation point on that experience. I don't know.
Well, here's a question. Are you the type of person, or were you at the time, who would have let things go, where you would have, if the experience hadn't been that drastic and hadn't, because the two components to it are that there's this impossible aspect to it, but then there's also confirmation through a prediction. Right. Which spills out into the real world, which is something that you can't ignore. Do you think that you, if it were not presenting you something you can't ignore, that you could have ignored it?
No.
Okay. See, so some of these experiences, maybe they're just testing them out to be like, okay, what does she need? She's clearly not frightened. She's clearly not scared away. She's clearly not going to block this out and deny it. So what else should we do? I mean, I wonder if that's really like when you say at some point in life, they're sort of, goading you on into accepting this. It's like you're passing these tests or something. And then eventually, they're like, okay, you're ready for the next thing.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that definitely could be part of it because, boy, let me tell you, it hasn't stopped yet. The second experience really was out there. But yet, as I'll tell the story, I fully believe everything happened. I was in bed, just me and the dog, and she's curled up at the foot of the bed. And I'm in, that nice state of sleep where you're just falling off into sleep and just kind of, settling in. And I hear this incredibly beautiful harp music, just a harp. And I thought, oh my God, what is this? I was conscious enough to like crack an eye open and know that the TV's not on. So I thought, where's this music coming from? And it was absolutely stunning. And my other thought was like, it feels as though I could be in heaven. we all hear those, stories of heaven and the harp playing and all that, and God's there to greet you. And I'm thinking, oh my God. So I no sooner recognize, and I'm just enjoying this stunning, beautiful harp music, when I become aware that around me, I'm levitated off the bed, I am surrounded by this brilliant, brilliant light, golden light. I'm totally surrounded in this light, and I could see it. I could feel I'm levitated. And then it's as though my head, something was connected to my head, because like you know how if you're laying in bed, you know, back of your head, your crown area mm-hmm. is like against your headboard. So it felt like something was coming through the headboard and was attached to my head. And this energy was being shot through my head, through my entire body at such an incredible rate that I was vibrating completely. And it was so much that I can remember going, stop, stop. This, I've had energy experiences before. This was beyond something that I felt comfortable that I could handle. And I was just, you know, silently in my mind saying, turn this off. This is way too much. And so this is all happening. And then, you have like, not the night terrors, but, you know, sleep paralysis. So it's like, I'm not moving. I'm left having to have this energy coming through me. It didn't let up. I was starting to get a little nervous about, okay, what's going on here? And as soon as I had that thought, I heard the dog bark and I thought, oh, and I was able at that point, hearing her bark, you know, just interrupted what was happening. And I can remember it was as though I'm back on the bed. There's no light. The heart music stopped. But I look over at the window because she's barking at something. She's looking at the window. And I look over and I'm not kidding you when I say there was this little like, honestly, like a leprechaun. He looked exactly like a leprechaun. He jumped in 3D, full 3D, jumped into through one of the panes of the window, and it was like a 6x6 paned window glass. He jumped through one of the corner panes, fully into the room. The dog is freaking out. I can see him so clearly. He has red hair. Of course, he's a leprechaun. He has a red beard. He's in striped overalls. He's in a striped shirt. He jumps into the room. The dog freaks, and I see this being run out of the bedroom into the living room area. And I thought, what is going on here? This is bizarre. And so again, I can't tell you what's going on, but it was real. I mean, I can say that I just know intuitively that I had the experience. It wasn't like I was dreaming, because I can, I remember this so distinctly, and each, you know, I don't speak of it often, but when I do, I have full recall on what had happened.
And did the leprechaun do anything? I mean, did he gesture to you in any way?
No, huh. Just like a huge grin on his face as he jumped through the window pane and ran. And so then, the dog did jump off the bed, but and then, of course, you know, I'm waking up. I'm trying to adjust to what the heck just happened. And I did walk through the house, and there was nothing else around the house. But, yeah, it was crazy. You know, part of me thinks that perhaps I was, I tapped into something. You know, there's something about that elemental energy of the leprechaun. What was happening to me, you know, you hear people talk that, you know, we're visited, you know, at night, you know, we get worked on, they're upgrading our DNA. You know, I have no idea, you know.
Are you Irish at all? Do you have Irish in you?
I am, even though I married an Italian. Yeah, Tierney is my maiden name. I can say I am pretty close to the elemental, you know, realms. You know, I enjoy, you know, walking, you know, through the woods. I'm very connected to the animals, to the nature spirits and all of that. And where I live, we're on sacred Wampanoag land. So it's lovely land. It's very, very, very spiritual. You know, I have seen some of the native spirits in the woods. So I'm at a loss for that one as well.
Well, wait, when you see native spirits in the woods, What is your sense of what they're doing, if you have a sense of it?
They're watching me. A lot of times what happens is they'll watch me. They'll follow me. And there have been times, though, when I have seen groups of them, women and children in particular. There's original Native American paths that are near this house I'm in now, and I have seen them walking as a group. The dog sees them. I could tell that she also, she'll watch too. But they're very friendly. It's pretty cool.
Do you think that if the average person were next to you, that they would see these things?
No.
Why is that?
Good question. Not sure. Maybe just not open to it. I don't know. I guess since a kid, I've kind of had this, seeing my grandfather in spirit. I guess, I've seen spirit. I've seen spirit in 3D. So I guess there's something about me with gifts I've been, blessed with, I guess you could say.
So when you talk to friends and family about this, I'm assuming you've talked to someone at some point, at this point in your life, right? If you talk to anyone who doesn't have these experiences, what is their take of you? Does it change it or no? I mean, do they believe you? Do they believe you believe it? Do they not believe? What is their take?
Anybody I've shared it with have been friends who are also, pretty open, spiritual people, on a similar path, have mediumistic abilities, they can communicate to spirit. So those friends, they buy it. They don't question the experience.
Okay. Yeah. The reason I ask is I think about when I told my roommates about this stuff back when I lived in New York and, or even my own family, if they don't have these types of experiences, it's that, they're willing to listen. They believe I believe it. They don't know what to make of it or whatever. It's that kind of blasé attitude. Yeah. And it just strikes me as odd because I think, if I thought that someone were lying, I wouldn't want to be friends with them. If I thought they were delusional, I would want to get them help. But if I thought that they were telling the truth, then this should be the most amazing thing I've ever heard. And it should be life-altering in some way. But it seems like it just falls on deaf ears or a shrug of the shoulder. It just seems like an odd reaction to me from people. So look forward to that.
To be honest, I have not shared any of this with my family. It's just now my brother and sister. My parents have passed, but they would look at me like I'm crazy, as I had mentioned before.
But they would just go on with life. You know what I mean? They look at you like you're crazy, but then it's just accepted. Oh, that's just her. That's just how she, where is our wonder in life? I guess is what I'm saying. When someone is presenting you something so wondrous, where is the wonder in life? Or if you honestly think they're crazy, why aren't you having an intervention? You know what I mean? It just seems like a weird blasé attitude about something so wild. And yet here we are. This is what we do.
Yeah. They do know I can communicate to spirit. That's been something that's kind of, I've shared with them, some communication with my parents and so they do kind of know I that's something I can do. The other experiences, my sacred travel, some of these experiences, as I just spoke of that happened in the house, I've not shared. I just haven't.
Mm-hmm. And so you have here, maybe you were sort of getting to it with the Indian sightings or visions, but that at sacred sites, you seem to have a lot of visions and that they'll show you places, how the place looked in ancient times. Do you know of a reason why they would do that?
What I've come to understand is a lot of this for me and is related to past lives. So, for instance, you know, my travels in Egypt were amazing. And I was traveling. That's where I met William and Claire Henry. William Henry's on Ancient Aliens. And it was one of their tours to Egypt that it just all fell into place. We had a mutual friend, and there was one spot left that had opened up. You know, she called me, I took it, and boom, I'm off to Egypt. But, you know, that in Egypt was where I had I had many encounters. But what I think is so cool about my trip to Egypt is that prior to leaving, a couple of nights before I left, I had a reading by a medium, and she was telling me, she said, Spirit's telling me three things are going to happen to you on this trip. So I said, okay. So it was soul retrieval, astral travel, and an alien encounter. So she couldn't even believe that she was delivering this message to me. And I said, wow, okay. So I kind of took it all with a grain of salt. And I'm not kidding you, those three things happened. And it was quite something. Yikes. And so in Egypt in particular, I was given very clear visions while, you know, I was at the foot of the Sphinx. It feels like it's past life because the visions take over. So in that particular vision, I look down and again, I'm by myself at the Sphinx. The rest of our group kind of had dispersed away. So I'm on my own. And all of a sudden I'm in the visions kind of take on a form of like a little mini movie. It's like I drop into this little movie and I look down, I could tell I'm a female. I'm in a total white gown. I'm carrying an infant, and the infant is dressed very elaborately in white and gold cloth. And I knew I'm very detached from this infant, so I knew it wasn't mine. But yet I'm in a procession of others who are dressed in white, and we're approaching the Sphinx. And in the middle of the Sphinx, which I did note when I was there, is like an altar piece. And I remember noting that the stellar message board was not there. Stone was not there. It was just this altar, and yet it had these four posts going up, and there was this beautiful golden fabric created like a tent effect above this altar. And then there were all these priests, everybody else was dressed in white also, that were, you know, standing in an arch behind the altar. So my procession approaches, I hand over the child to what appears to be the head priest standing on the other side of the altar stone. And then I back up and the experience ends. It's quick as they come in, they can end. But yet I was left with the distinct thoughts that, gosh, I think what I was just shown was an offering of this child. And I guess they did do that way back in history, the ancient history, for, you know, sacrifice, for the rains, for, you know, the offerings for successful crops, all of that. So I don't know where I got that thought, but that was a distinct thought I had because I was very detached from this child. So that's kind of how it rolls. it was interesting, that vision.
My cynical mind just went, yeah, we still have that. It's called going to war over resources. We just don't call it human sacrifice, but we still do it. Kind of true. Here's a question for you. Go down this outlandish road with me. All of these things happening in the sense of past lives, that's linear, but in the nonlinear version of now, where everything is happening right now, from that perspective, could all of these past lives actually be aspects of you happening right now. And some of these people are more awake than others. And so they know that to achieve ultimate oneness, they have to wake each aspect of themselves up. It's one waking oneself up. Could something like that be what's going on?
Gosh, I don't know. I hadn't thought of it that way. Sure. I don't know.
Run with it. Take it and run with it. I give that to you.
Well, I certainly do have my share of seeing past lives. I mean, all over the world. And then to have, you know, people who, not knowing me, you know, read me and say, okay, so they're seeing what happened. And so, you know, I've had some confirmation sometimes with some of this. But I don't know, Jeremy. It's very, I don't know.
So there are some random things in here I've never heard of. Like, I don't know what this would be. I mean, I know what Reiki is. I know what Akashic Records are. But Akashic Records training and integrated energy therapy. I'm not sure what that would be. What are those things?
Integrated. They're just, you know, they're just healing modalities, you know, tapping into using, you know, the energies, the universal energies. And for me, the integrated energy therapy, there's a piece of that where you can connect to the angelic realm. And you call in the angelic healing angels. And so they, you know, if you're working on somebody, they take their place at each part of the body. And you work in tandem with them for healing. So, you know, the Reiki was a big opening for me, channeling the healing energies. So that's, you know, so it was kind of like I'm guided again to take these types of you know, energy trainings, modalities, and each one brings another piece on to, you know, for me to almost like tools in my toolbox. So I just kind of, I've learned over the years to just kind of go with the flow. And so that, you know, each training, each, you know, tool in that toolbox, I kind of am now putting together, you know, and just, you know, as an open channel, using all of those methods to kind of do my own form of healing. And I've had others, you know, see that for me, that's been something that was foretold that I would be doing, you know, and I'm my own version of kind of the hands-on healing, like you do with Reiki. So, yeah.
No one's ever foretold to do math. You ever notice that?
Yeah, really, huh? Well, and you know, the other piece of that is, you know, I went off to Guatemala on a whim and a prayer, and I, you know, that's where I trained it, you know, using, you know, the quantum healing realms, and that's where I got my Egyptian healing rods. And so I'm tapping into that whole Egyptian healing thing, the wands of Horus. And, you know, that's, again, a very ancient healing modality. And if you ever look, when you're seeing some of the pharaohs depicted, you know, especially in carved statuary, 9 times out of 10, they're holding Egyptian healing rods. So I was always drawn to this whole thing. And it truly is. I feel, you know, I've been doing this type of healing in many lifetimes going way back. And you know, in relation to that is then the shamanic postures, and it's all related. It's all related to energy flow. And so that's, so I've felt from the get-go that I'm just kind of being, you know, awakened to remember some of this healing, you know, this connecting to the universal life force energies that are there for all of us to tap into. And so it's just, it's interesting. You know, it seems probably random to probably, I'm sure, look at my list of what I've been up to. But, you know, I trust in that higher guidance that, you know, I'm here to remember and to do this type of work is part of the journey here for me.
So how did you come to this sense of positivity about it? Because it sounds like at least you had a fear associated with some of your experiences. So how did you tamper that fear? Because some people go in a completely different direction. Some people might go in an occult direction, or they might become paranoid or something. But then there are folks like you who end up, right, healing and into the spiritual modalities and putting trust in higher power and that sort of thing. How did you come to that place with this stuff? Do you remember?
You know, it truly was all just guided. I mean, I just kind of, you know, got to a point where I felt I never really, I know you mentioned fear. You know, those experiences I was just talking about, there wasn't a lot of fear attached to them, but it just, again, it was just kind of this guided thing. You know, I've learned to tap into, communicate with my guides, you know, and trust, you know, when they put something in front of me, I pay attention now. And so, you know, it's truly coming from a place of great trust and just knowing that, you know, what I need on this journey is going to be provided for me. I'm protected and I'm guided and I'm just trusting all that.
And when you look back at some of these events, do they all have meaning for you in a narrative way? Like, do you look at them and go, oh yeah, I see what that is. That led to this, this, and this. That led to this. This was all necessary.
Yeah, there's a big picture. There truly is. And I can step back and see that because, you know, for instance, just to kind of give you an idea how it works for me with say, my guides. You know, I had many people through readings or, you know, a medium I had been training with or whatever, you know, say to me, gosh, Spirit's showing me that you're going to be doing, they're calling it sacred travel. You're going to be, you know, traveling all over the world, having these sacred experiences. And I can remember thinking, okay, how in God's name is that going to happen? So, you know, it's stuff like that. So then, you know, fast forward a year, and what happens is when I'm in Guatemala taking that training, I meet this gentleman, Finbar Ross. And what does Finbar do for a living? Well, he owns a company called Sacred Mystical Journeys. So, boom, he and I connect. I'm then on this wonderful journey with Finbar and a group of fabulous ladies going to Israel, having an incredible experience there. And then it was through Finbar that I meet this gal, Carol, who then was, you know, friends with William and Claire Henry. And that's how I got to Egypt. So it's so funny. I'm being guided. I'm being provided the incredible opportunities to do this type of travel. It's as though they're putting it on my path very meaningfully to have these experiences and to have it safely. You know, all of these travels I've done, you know, going to Israel, Egypt, Italy, England, France. I mean, it's all guided travel. It's safe travel with people of like mind who, they're my vehicle to get to these places. So it's like they set it all up for me. It's almost like I don't have to do a lot of, you know, heavy lifting here. They're really kind of putting all this on my path in an absolutely beautiful way. So I've just truly learned to just, okay, yep, for whatever reason, I'm being called to go, let's say, to go to England. And, you know, again, I have these incredible experiences there. And I trust it all.
And that's at Stonehenge, correct?
Stonehenge, Avebury, yep. Yeah. Glastonbury tour, yeah, all of it. It was just, and again, all related to past life incarnations there. I've had many druid past lives there at different periods of between the Roman Britain period, the prehistoric Britain period. And then, you know, and that period was when they were finishing up the last phase of building Stonehenge. So, you know, I go now current time back to these places of my soul. And I have these incredible, again, Spirit shows me, you know, like a little movie, a glimpse of the past life I had there. And in particular at Avebury, very powerful, because those standing stones of Avebury, which still hold amazing healing energy, I was shown how we use those stones, you know, as a druid priestess, how we would, you know, use those healing stones, along that walkway of stones. So yeah, it truly isn't random what's happening here.
Well, those visions of past lives, are those, now that one is particularly useful, but are they all something that you feel like you needed to see, or were some of them random snippets of past life that you just sort of had?
No, I think each one is truly guided for a reason. So it's a lifetime that had an impact, that was a powerful lifetime then. And so I'm being shown it now so that it registers for me that, okay. And again, it's awakening to remember. That's a key piece here for me. And so it's remembering, you know, the lifetime, being shown, for instance, how the stones are used in Avebury. There was, you know, Stonehenge. Again, those stones hold incredible, powerful energies. Our group was at Stonehenge, and they, a group of them started toning, just making these beautiful toning sounds, trying to create like a vibrational feel with the stones. And I tell you, I walked up to the group of them. I'm not big into toning myself, but I appreciate it. And as I walked up, the most incredible thing I saw with my physical eyes was that there was waves of energy coming out of the stone that they were toning at. I'd never seen anything like it in my life. And after they finished their toning, I told them what I saw. And they physically couldn't see what I saw, but they could feel the energy. It was that powerful. But it was cool to see it on a physical level, the waves of the of the vibration coming out of the stone.
And did you say that you saw how Stonehenge was built?
There's a piece of that I was shown. And it has to do with sound. So the snippet I saw of that was there is a sound in water. There is a round circle around Stonehenge that back in the day held water, and that everyone would stand around the henge. And again, it was the toning. They were making these incredible sounds, was what I was shown. And they were doing it as a group. It was very powerful. And it was like sound that almost went above an octave that hurt your ears. And that's all I saw. And I thought, okay, what is this all about? But then if you do kind of go down that rabbit hole, there are those out there who are discovering that sound, again, in the Great Pyramid, same thing, that sound was, you know, a powerful tool that was used in these ancient cultures, the megahertz, that whole thing. So there might be something to all that.
Okay. And then in this period of time, you have here Strange Encounter Climbing the Glastonbury Tor. What was that?
Okay.
And yeah, what is the Glastonbury Tor?
Glastonbury Tor is that beautiful, it's a very ancient mound that has, you know, round grooves made into it. What I believe is, you know, the Druids, they would walk the tour. So they would walk up it. It's a spiral. So of course there's that whole energy thing. And then at some point they built St. Michael's Tower on top. So that's not as ancient as the tour itself. So we're there as our group. Again, I'm traveling with William and Claire Henry. And, you know, my group's kind of ahead of me. It's very interesting. I tend to have everybody around me leave at points where I have these encounters alone, which I find a little interesting, but I guess it allows it to happen. But so everyone else is ahead of me, and and it's kind of a steep climb up to the tour. So I'm, you know, stepping up each part of the tour, and I look up and I see there's this man coming down towards me, and no one else is around us. And so I look up and I thought, very narrow pathway. So I thought, okay, so one of us is going to have to step off the pathway to pass each other. So I'm going up and he's coming down. And as he approaches, he has this really funny smile on his face. And as he comes up to me, I'm looking at him. He looks directly in my eyes, and he has this funny little laugh, and he looks at me and he says, "I see you." And I went, "What?" And he walks right by me. And I thought, what is this? And I intuitively knew this was not a normal exchange, that this was something, this was something. Because as I turned around to see what the heck was this guy up to, he's not there. There's nobody behind me. So now the seconds of that happening and me turning around, that guy should have still been on the path. And he wasn't. And nobody else was behind me. So I thought, okay, what just happened? So that did freak me out a little bit. So again, it's like, okay, so was that a message for me that it's like, okay, you know, my, you know, spirit's out there saying, okay, we see you. Again, I don't really have, you know, I really couldn't tell you exactly what that was all about.
Do you have time for a few more questions?
Sure. Yeah.
Okay. Cause I definitely want to get to Xenos. Cause when I first read the name Xenos, I thought, this is going to be some sort of channeled alien entity thing. And then it sounds like he's a person in the world. So I can't wait to get to that. But you have here a past life encounter at Lourdes, which sounds pretty extraordinary because it rocked you to your soul. So let's hear this.
Jeremy, goodness. Yeah. Lourdes, again, you know, guided to take this trip. And again, with William and Claire Henry. And a lovely group of souls. And I have a dear friend, Hillary Harley, who's an astrologer. I had her read my chart right before this trip. And I'll tell you, the planetary alignments around the time I was going to be in Lourdes were just like, she was blown away by the charting of this. She said, Kathy, she said, Uranus is, and I'm not big, I don't know all my astrology stuff, so I'm going to try and replicate what she said. Uranus was toggling my midheaven. It's very powerful. Uranus is, you know, shock. It's electrical currents. It's, you know, big stuff. And, you know, it's all saying, you know, something's going to be happening here. This alignment, there's going to be something going to happen. And so I'm kind of like, it was almost like, you know, I was getting a little heads up here. So I thought, okay, I'm going. So the minute we got into Lourdes, it was almost like my first, you know, I can remember looking, going, oh my gosh, this is an affront. It was almost like they created this Christian Disney world. I mean, it was like, you know, all the hotels were above all of these stores that were selling glow-in-the-dark Madonnas and tchotchkes. And I thought, oh my God, this is a sacred place. Why was it allowed to get so, you know, touristy? And goodness. So it was really kind of an affront. And I thought, okay, why is this bothering me? But anyway, and so I, you know, as I'm at Lourdes, one of the big things you do when you're there at Lourdes is to, you know, go into the baths, you know, go in and dunk into the sacred waters of Lourdes. And Lourdes is where the Blessed Mother appeared to Bernadette at the grotto. And so, you know, it's very sacred land. And I've always had an attraction to that story of Bernadette. And, you know, we did go to Bernadette's family home in Lourdes, where her father was a flour. He ran a flour mill. I did, you know, hear the family in the house. I felt very much that was a house full of love. They were very, very poor. But, you know, it just kind of, it was neat to kind of tap into Bernadette there. And so when I went to the baths, we had agreed as a group to meet there at 2:00 and go through. And what happens is the baths are right next to the grotto where Bernadette saw the Blessed Mother, and they instantly separate. You know, there's a men's queue and a woman's queue. So all of us, you know, all the ladies, and of course, you know, at the women's queue, like at the ladies' restrooms, you know, the lines out the door and around the building. And so my friend Mary, and, you know, her given name is Mary Magdalene, her and I were late. So we weren't in the queue line with the rest of our group. So we, you know, got in behind, you know, there were probably 30 people in between, you know, us and our group. So, you know, we're very slowly going through the line, quite a slow process. And, you know, the whole time, you know, I'm kind of in a state of prayer, just, you know, kind of getting ready for this sacred experience of going into the waters. And so as we get closer, and it was this, I kept getting this incredible sense of fear that came over me that is, I couldn't explain it at the time. And the closer we got to the going into the bath area, I started to cry and sob. And Mary's looking at me, and I said, I don't know what's going on here, but I really am getting this panic feeling. Like I gotta leave here. I gotta leave. And she puts her arm around me. She says, so cute. She had such a heavy Boston accent. She said, doll, you've come too far to run away from this now. You're staying. And I'm right here. We'll do this together. And I thought, oh my gosh, okay, I guess I have come far to do this. So I kept trying to calm myself down. And so we went into the next phase of a curtained area. Honestly, to me, looking back, it's so much like the Wizard of Oz behind the curtain thing. It was really quite comical. So we go into another curtained area, and we're that much closer to the bath area. And, you know, you kind of can hear the splashing. And we're sitting together, Mary and I, on this very old wooden bench, waiting to then go into the next curtained area. And mind you, they have volunteers who are kind of ordering you around. They're queuing you to, you know, you can come in. So one person leaves, they'll call in the next person. Excuse me. And so I'm sitting there, and I am now uncontrollably crying. I can barely breathe. I'm having what probably people would think would be a panic attack. I've never had one in my life, but it was that feeling of I've got to flee. I've got to get out of here. And so just as I'm, you know, again, Mary's trying to calm me down, then she's motioned to go into a dressing room to the left. And I'm sitting there on this bench now by myself, and I'm really starting to panic. And so I'm thinking, okay, well, you'll get called next and you'll go into the same dressing area as Mary. Well, that didn't happen. I get called into another dressing area. So at this point, I'm crying uncontrollably. I go through the curtain. These women, what happens? See, I didn't know any of this. I wasn't sure how this was going to play out. So when you go through the curtain to the dressing area, undressing area, I should say, before you get into the bath area, these women come up to you, two women come up, and they help you take off your clothes. You strip naked, not comfortable with that. They put this cloak around you, and it's like a very dark black navy cloak. And you take off your clothes, and it's freezing in there. And, you know, you hang your clothes on a wooden peg, and then these women who are, you know, French and chatting, and, you know, they motion you to sit down. And mind you, now I've lost it. I'm sobbing. And, you know, I could tell they're like whispering between each other and looking at me, and they probably didn't know what to do with me. And I kept sitting there, and other people were going into the waters, you know, ahead of me that, you know, weren't there when I first sat down. So I thought, okay, maybe they're waiting for me to calm down. So then I can gesture that, you know, is it my turn to go? And she nodded her head. So I had these women escort me to the next curtained area, and you could hear the splashing. And so I go through that curtained area, and I stop. And I'm like, I can't do this. And I'm sobbing. And this woman grabs me and walks me up. So what the bath area is it's like a cement tub area, I guess you'd call it, filled halfway up, probably, you know, with a foot of very cold, dirty water. And there's two steps down into this bath area. And on the far wall is this ceramic mother and child, Madonna and child, you know, plaque on the wall. And so I have this woman come up who says to me, she whispers in my ear, and she says in very heavy French accent, she said, "Look at the Madonna. Tell that you tell your intentions to the Madonna." And I'm speechless. I'm sobbing still, and I can't even put two words together, and I just shake my head. And she kept saying that to me, "Tell your intentions to the Madonna." I'm like, "My God, what is going on here?" So then there are two women on the other end of the bath who dunk in this white, like, shroud, very thin material into the water, roll it up, squeeze it out, and they walk towards me. And I thought, what's happening here? And so the other two women drop the cape that I had on. They wrap you in this white, thin shroud, and which is freezing cold, and then they motion for you to go down the stairs into the water. Well, at this point, I am having none of it. I'm like, nope, I gotta go. I can't do this. I'm crying uncontrollably, and they're forcing me down the stairs. So I'm now in the water. So then they take me by, like, the shoulders, and they dip you. They tell you to kneel down, and they dip you back in the water. And did it so quickly, and I shot up, and I, and the course of water is so cold. I shot up. And I screamed and I said, "No." And then, because then they were trying to put me forward into this water. And I said, no, I've got to go. I can't stay here. And I take myself out of the bath. And so at that point, there were two other women who were there who come over to me who I hadn't seen before. And they're taking off that white shroud thing. And they're, again, trying to put me back into that dark wrap cape thing. And they walk me back into the dressing room. And I can remember noting that I hadn't seen them before. And they appeared to be speaking in Italian, which I thought was interesting. Very lovely. One older woman, she looked to be in about maybe her mid to late 70s. And another woman was probably, you know, maybe in her late 60s. They come up to me. They were so loving and kind. They wrapped me up. I'm crying uncontrollably still. I can't get myself together. I almost collapsed. They catch me. The older woman takes me as though she's holding a child, and she puts my head on her chest, and she pats my head, and she's like saying beautiful things in my ear in Italian, which I have no idea, and like she would a child. And I just relaxed into her embrace. The other woman came from behind. She also embraced me, and I just cried. I was grateful. I was out of that bath area. I'm out of the water, and I'm into the arms of these beautiful women who are comforting me at a very crazy time. Because I still don't know what that was all about. I mean, that's so not like me to have that kind of reaction. So they very carefully helped me dress because I was still kind of shaken and weak. And so they're helping me dress. And so I'm dressed, and of course, mind you, there's no towel. So you got a cold, wet body that you're now trying to put your clothes back on into. And the older woman comes up and she hugs me like a hug like I've never had before. Honest to God, it was beautiful. And then she takes my face in her hands and she kisses both cheeks. And she's kind of talking to me in Italian. It sounded beautiful, whatever she was saying. And then the other woman did the exact same thing. And I was moved, and I had stopped crying at that point, but I was moved to tears by their absolute kindness. And I then grabbed each one of their faces and I kissed both their cheeks and I bowed and I thanked them. And, you know, I kind of stumbled out into the real world again. And I just was like, oh my God, whatever just happened in there was, I can't even put into words. I truly can't. Something happened. And I came out, tried to find my friend Mary. I'm shaken. I'm having a hard time kind of keeping my balance. And she finds me and we just hug each other. She, you know, she had an equally not great experience and, but not anywhere near mine. And so, you know, we join another woman who had a kind of funky experience as well. And the three of us in sharing our experience, we had the sense of, you know, we're not going to let the others know what happened to us here. I knew for myself, was not going to speak of it to the rest of the group. And I found out afterwards, so this will segue into my teacher, Zenos, who came on my path about 2014. He is a very advanced soul. When he was alive, he was living in Australia, and he would be very instrumental for me in that he would speak to me of my past lives, but only the past lives that I myself had experienced or could remember. He would never, you know, give you anything that you don't already have a sense of. So I shared with him in a very detailed letter my experiences that happened to me at Lourdes. And he wrote back to me and broke it all down for me as to what happened, that was in fact a past life. It was a incredible, I had to go through this, an incredible like karmic release of a past life. And I had actually two past lives at the Sacred Springs at Lourdes. And the second past life is the one I had to relive there in the baths. And there are two levels of grottos. And I was drawn to the top grotto from the day one of going into Lourdes. And it turns out that in this particular past life, I was what he referred to as a Breton craft witch, which was a white witch. We were healers, and I was in charge of the upper pool in the upper grotto, and I had a group of people who were part of my group that we would guard the waters. And he told me that I died in that lifetime in the exact same spot where those waters are, and that I was drowned by a group of radical Christians who had come in and raided the forest, killing all of the women witches who were there. So I died a very horrible death there. And the part of that death that I guess I had not released was I was in charge of these other women, and I had carried around with me from that lifetime on till now, you know, the sense that I carried the guilt that I could not save them and that they perished with me there at that spot. And the reason for me to go back was that I had to relive that death and survive and have my friends there. So my friend Mary, the other gal, we were in that lifetime together. So we were all meant to travel back to be able to release what happened to us in that lifetime, me in particular, to let go of that guilt that I had been carrying. And that, you know, by doing so, by reliving that incredible, horrible death, it has opened something for me. It was like, you know, picture taking a ton of bricks off your shoulders kind of thing. And it's advanced me on my spiritual path. But the best part of the story is Zenos did explain to me that the two women who were in the bath, who were so kind to me, the older woman was my grandmother in that lifetime. The other woman was my mother in that lifetime. And that's, it was all very karmic. We were meant to come together at that moment to be able to, you know, have me release, you know, that guilt, you know, to let go of that, experience, and not to carry it any further in this lifetime. So it was quite remarkable what happened at Lourdes. So I'll probably never go back, but I did the work when I was there, and I was able to really, it was a huge cleansing, releasing, and I had, it was all destined for me to be there, for it to happen. So again, this is how it rolls, Jeremy, is that, you know, I'm kind of guided, and they provide me with all of this. You know, I'm provided, you know, traveling with William and Claire. I'm provided with these friends who you know, I met in this lifetime, but they were meant to be there as well, you know, because we had our place together in that past lifetime. And so it's quite magical, truly, these experiences.
Well, yeah. And how could you not go to that place with someone named Mary Magdalene? I mean, that seems destined.
Jeremy, I love that you pick up on that, because that's what I kept saying after the fact. I'm like, okay, this is how my guides roll. Great. I have to relive this horrific death, but boy, thank you for having me sit next to Mary Magdalene.
Is that really her given name? Like that was her, that her parents was her, named her that?
Yes, it was a family name. Yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
And yeah. Was her, do you remember if her experience was related to that?
I shared with her, she knew she had, you know, it was a funny experience. You know, she just felt that, okay, I don't care for what's going on here. This doesn't feel very sacred to me. You know, cause you know, you're stripped naked. It was just like, I guess we didn't quite realize all of that was going to entail. And so, it was a very uncomfortable feeling for them. You know, and I did share with both that, you know, what I learned about why we were there. And to be honest, I'm not sure how much of that really resonated, for both. I'm not sure.
Okay. And so when you have these, I don't know, emotional attachments to past life transgressions, let's call them, when you have them lift, do you feel it leave your body? Like, you know how we carry emotional weight in certain parts of our body? Yeah. Did you feel anything like that?
Yes. Oh, that was huge. I mean, intuitively, I knew while I was still there at the bath, and especially at the end with those two women, I had the absolute clear thought when they were hugging me and caring for me that they've done this before for me, that there's a past life connection here with these women. I intuitively knew that. So to have, you know, to then find out that was a correct feeling, that knowing was true. It was remarkable. I will never forget the love that they gave me. I'm going to like truly go into tears here because it was so profound, you know, but yeah, no. And that's where I say, you know, trust the journey. If it wasn't for Mary Magdalene, I would have run out of that place and never looked back. But because of her saying, you've got to stay, doll, you've got to stay, I was able to have that huge, huge release. And my friend Hillary Harley, she saw it all mapped out in the universe. I mean, I'll tell you know, you couldn't find a more shocking experience. What Uranus, you know, you were aligned right there for that one. So, yeah.
So pretty profound. You have these profound experiences, and they shape you in some way. They clear you up of whatever was wrong, let's say. And so do you have a sense that you have to do something with it, that you have to give back?
Yes.
What is it that you want to do? I mean, I know that you had mentioned, you know, other people having these experiences are sort of reassuring them that they're okay and that sort of thing. But do you have like sort of an ultimate sense of, okay, because once you're done doing that, what really is your life about in this life with this?
You know, there's a piece of service. You know, there's the healing piece. There's a teaching piece that's starting to happen. And, you know, and again, Jeremy, let me say this to you. Look at the unfolding just between Ig, you, and I. And I'm at a point in my journey where I'm starting to write all of these incredible experiences down. You know, it might be a little book, I'm not sure, to share with others. But then I have this wonderful opportunity to come on your show, and it certainly doesn't get by me that your show is called The Experience, and that, you know, you're allowing me to have a voice, Jeremy. And that's huge, because there are people out there, I believe, who are having these awakenings, these experiences. I think each of us, we all have them. And it's, you know, perhaps, you know, somebody might have a little bit more knowledge about a certain phenomena, or, you know, and that's brought to your path. So in a way to probably help explain maybe what you're going through, and by hearing someone else's story. And that's kind of how it's worked for me through the years, is I've had amazing people come on my path truly, it's a collection of soul family. We have shared past lives together. There are those who are awakened enough to know that, you know, so that they accept that we are family. And I just, you know, I just want to, you know, kind of, I guess, be in a place of service that, you know, to have someone, you know, help them trust their journey and, you know, listen to their soul's calling. Because for me, this is a soul level work. This is very deep work. It's all soul based.
And you know that sound means our time is just about up. But first, let's get to your listener feedback. Let's see. I'm just going to pick a comment at random and answer it or talk to this person from last month's episode. Let me see here. Eeny, meeny, miny, mo. Ah, Mace. Mace is one of those listeners who has usually really constructive, sort of interesting things to say. Let's see what Mace has to say about last month's episode. Mace writes, quote, Mace, end quote. Okay, so a little shorter this time. Not as much to unpack. Well, that went well. All right. Anyway, my thanks again to Kathy Cogliano for coming on the show. Ig for uniting us. And everyone out there for listening. If you are a non-subscriber, again, I implore you, click the subscribe tab. Get this show, get Dreamland absolutely commercial-free in their entireties. And everything else Whitley has to offer at Unknown Country. Plus a sense of community. Oh, that's right. Because only subscribers get to comment in the comments section. And I love hearing those comments. I love reading them. So, subscribers, get on the ball, will you? Non-subscribers, subscribe so that I can read something. Because clearly, these people are not holding up their end of the bargain. I kid. At any rate, we will see you back here in a month with another two-hour spectacular. I can already tell you that in the first hour, I interview Crystal and Robert. I have interviewed them separately. I am interviewing them together because in the last couple of weeks, they had a fairly, I don't know, fundamental. I mean, I want to say amazing, but really in terms of paranormal, trickster, synchronistic stuff, as amazing as it is, it's kind of like one of the fundamentals of things that happen where it's like the question of, is this event mundane? Does it have a conventional explanation or not? And then when you figure out that it does, that's when it seems to be used in a way that implies an intelligence is actually using the mundane thing to send a message of some sort or to somehow communicate something. So I'll just leave it that vague for now. And we'll talk to them in about a month. All right. Take care, everybody. Until then, if you want to be on the show, in fact, if you want to be on the second half of that show, if you want to do a commentary on any of the shows that you've seen, there's a whole lot we can do here with 2 hours. It doesn't have to be 2 hours of an interview. It can be, you know, like next one is an hour long interview and then an hour to fill. How do we fill it? I could do another interview. I could do news articles. You could come on and read news if you want of the paranormal ufological variety. Do a commentary, give a movie review on maybe a documentary you've seen that you liked. There's all sorts of stuff we can do here. Let's paint up this canvas. We got a whole lot of canvas to work with now. So be my guest. It'll be fun. Write to me, Jeremy@unknowncountry.com. If any of that piques your interest or if you have another idea that you would like to come on and do or have me do, let me know. All right, everybody. Thanks again for listening. And we will see you next time.